a pencil and paper if you wish to do some of these things. So I won't require you to enter any commands, but you can. There will be like a pen and paper computer that you can simulate on your own pen and own paper. And then there'll be a homework challenge problem. And then if you can think of a good award that people can have to have who complete the homework challenge problem, then that can also. Okay, so the agenda is we're gonna. What is a computer? We'll go over who Turing was just briefly. The machine that is defined as a Turing machine. Then we'll talk about the. A couple of examples, and then the universal Turing machine. We'll have to talk about that. Then I'm going to switch to describing what a universal register machine is, or sometimes it's a counting machine, and that's equivalent to a Turing machine, but it's much closer to the CPU and the memory that exists in your modern computer today. So basically the point of me switching to that model at halfway through is the idea that you might get a better idea of like what your chip is, like what's happening when you write a program on your computer at the very lowest level possible. So like there's no mystery, like okay, you write a computer program, it gets interpreted, you know, some magic happens, but like what is that magic exactly is the answer. Here's what we'll answer by looking at the register machine. Then we'll look at two examples that we'll walk through on pen and paper, and then the last one thing to do is to look at the challenge. So who wants to answer the question of what a computer is, or like give a good definition for a computer? Okay.
An entity that performs a calculation.
A calculation, okay. And what calculation, like all calculations, like what is the domain of calculation?
If you're talking a human computer, it's anything a human can do.
Yeah.
If we're talking a mechanical computer, well, whatever the machine, whatever it was built to be able to, right? So it's set either by the culture or the construction of the calculator or the computer.
Okay, that's a good answer. I see you have your hand. Do you want to give us an alternative?
No, I was pointing out
there was a chair. Okay. Does anybody else want to? I guess there's not a correct. Well, there is like one really, really correct answer, but there's like at the moment not a correct answer. I mean, an idea is just to think about like what we mean when we say computer. Yeah.
I would say that performs tasks based on basic on or off, yes or no commands.
So something, that's like a side topic we can talk about, which is really good, like something that can give a determination to like a question, maybe, which is like an on or off, like a binary can give a result. So that's like, that's the halting problem, so if we have time, I'll discuss that as well. Does anybody know how to talk about what the word halting problem is in German? Because it's like originally German, it's got a really fun name, but I can't remember.
What problem?
The halting problem? It's like Entschuldigung's problem.
It would be one giant word.
Entschuldigung's cat?
Okay, so we'll talk about what it means for a computer to fall.
I was going to go back to what a computer is.
Okay.
I was going to say a machine that can follow instructions.
Can follow instructions?
Yeah.
Yeah, that is a close definition to what is going to end up being defined. So there was kind of like a race, not really a race to do this, but it would eventually, the definition that most people crowd around today is this notion of the Turing machine, and like a computer, we now define a computer to be something that can emulate the Turing machine. So it's any machine that can simulate the machine that I'm going to, that Turing defined, and it will come to be a little bit circular, but it will make sense because the Turing machine is a machine that can perform any computation. Like, it's proven to be able to perform any algorithm that can be defined in a specific language, which is similar to one. So if you can prove that you're like a Turing machine, then you're done because the Turing machine has been proven to be able to perform all algorithms that can be described by humans, if they're sufficiently articulated. Okay.
Solve pi?
What's that?
Can it solve pi?
Yeah, and Gauss can recite all the digits of pi backwards. So, yeah, it can compute pi to an arbitrarily high precision. So, Turing was a clever person that was unfortunately prosecuted for being homosexual in post-war prison. And that's just a side note that needs to be said, because I think that's important, because it was like, oh yeah, you gave us computers, but we still hated you because you were homosexual, and then, like, the society couldn't see past the end of its nose. Okay, so, a Turing machine, as it's stylized in the Wikipedia, kind of looks something like this. Let's get to it. People have built these, but it was in 1936 or something, it was theorized, and this is a piece of tape, and it's, you can imagine it as being infinitely long in both directions, but it will never be infinite, but like, it just needs to be large, like it just needs to not have an end during this computation. Like, in some ways, the Turing machine can never exist because it requires an infinite amount of memory, but in other ways, like, it's not practical because anything, it will never use an infinite amount of memory. Then there's a box, which is like the machine, so there's the tape and it's infinite by direction. There's a machine, there's a head, and this is known as the head, and there is also this thing here, which is the state of the machine, so this is the head. And then, like, this is the state. And then, like, the head is reading one of the cells on the tape. And the state is one of a finitely many different states it can be in. So there's state, which is, like, a finite set. There's the tape, which is bi-infinite. And then there's the head, which reads the state. And then what am I missing? Oh, and then there's, like, a set of instructions. There's, like, the program that you feed it, which is a finitely long list of instructions. There's also an alphabet on this, so every one of these cells contains one letter from an alphabet. An alphabet is a finite list of characters, so it's like, those could be, traditionally we use 0 and 1 as a list of characters. You can use any. People think they're hardcore when they compute in binary, but in fact, the Turing machine only needs one character, and it's even more hardcore, and if you want to, you can code it with just 1 and not 0. So, you know, if you think when people want to say that you're hardcore. But you do need a blank character, so it's kind of like 1.5 digits. So you can use 1 and blank, and like not a character, which some people say is similar to like 0 and 1, because 0 can act as it, but you also have the blank character here. But yeah, the Turing machine can be programmed in unary, is the point. Okay, this is a Turing machine.
Does direction matter on the tape?
Okay, and then a program, the instructions are a list of instructions. And instructions always take this form. It says, it's like, this. There's like the in state, then there's then there's like the character at the head, so it's like what the head is reading. Oops. And then there is, it's fine, the character at the head, then there is the print, and then there is the direction. And then there is the out state. So the way you program a Turing machine is to make a sequence of things like this. And so it will say, like, okay, can somebody help just double check what there's, like, on the page, Wikipedia page for Turing machine, there's like a thing that talks about the very first Turing program. Uh, like under Turing machine example, I think. So the first program that was like written by Turing was the program that says there is a machine that can print the sequence 0 blank, 1 blank, 0 blank, 1 blank. And so I think, okay, so there are like, I think it's a five state program. So there's like state 1. Okay, so they do it this way. Okay, so after I write this, we will perform the machine, and then you will see just how boring it is to be a computer yourself. Okay. Instruction 1. If the state is B, and the tape symbol is blank, then print P0, move right, and move to the state C. If the state is C, and the symbol is blank, then print nothing, and move right, and move the state to E, and if the state is E, then you should, and the head is blank, because we're given a blank state, so we're just like, the goal at the moment is to print the sequence 010101, okay, infinitely. Then print P1, which is like symbol 1, so let's actually just call this 0. And then we'll call this 1, go right, move to the state F, okay, B, blank, print nothing, move right, go to B. Okay, so actually in Turing's initial specification of a computer, he meant that the computer would be a person. So like the first computer was actually just a person. And the Turing machine, okay, so this is how simple it is to be a Turing machine. You are supposed to be a person that can only see the head, only knows what's happening here, can only look and compare if the thing, the cell at the head is like the thing that I see in my list. And if it's that, then I'm going to change the head to the print, whatever is in this row. I'm going to move in the direction that whatever the direction tells me, and then I'm going to move to the next instruction. I'm going to move the state to the next instruction. I'm going to like fall asleep, become rebirth, and then like repeat that over and over again. So that is like how a human would do the work of a computer. So, okay, we have a blank tape in the Turing machine. I'm the Turing machine. Okay, there it is. We start in state, let's say we have an initial state B. That comes up here. Okay, I'm looking at the head. Head is blank. Print 0. 0 goes in here. Okay, move direction right. Okay, I'm going to shift this tape to right, and then I'm going to change the state into C. Then this is over here, so I moved right. Okay, go over again. Okay, what's happening? I'm looking at the head. I'm in state C. State C tells me that if it's blank, I don't do anything. I move the tape over right. Okay, so you can kind of see how this goes, and if this happens long enough, then this would like move over, and then you get a blank here, and then you print 1 here, and then you get a blank, and then you print 0, and then 1, and it would move, the state would move, and then the last state to move into is B, and then that would happen over and over and over. So that's the Turing machine. Does it seem completely pointless at the moment? Okay, Turing machines are like notorious for having being really boring. Can someone, there's like the copy thing, like how to copy a string, which would allow you to like maybe double a digit.
I think there might be an error because you have it go from C to E and then E to F, and then there's no in state to F.
Oh yeah, sorry. Okay.
There we go.
So that would be a program that would print that. I'm going to let you take it on, Will, that as an exercise to the reader about how to read a sequence of ones. Like, say that the, okay, so let's just think about it. Like, say there were some ones on this tape and I wanted to copy them. You would have to, like, say, if I see a one, move to the right and then move all the way to the right until I didn't see any ones anymore. And then I saw a zero, and then count how many ones I saw again there. Except I can't really count something, right? Because I have no way to store how many ones I've seen. So like you're just going to have to do it for like every you're gonna have to like see your one and then move past all the ones and then go back. So if there were like ones here and you wanted to copy them to here, you'd have to like look at this one, keep on moving until there were no ones anymore, put a one back, and then like go back until you saw no, then like change this to zero. So when you moved away from this, you would put this to zero. Then you'd move here, and then when this was blank again, you would have to move all the way back to here, and then like this would be zero, so this would be your first one here, and then you would change this to one, and then you would like put the ones over here. So like you can like copy stuff around, and because you can copy stuff around on the Turing machine, that allows you to do arithmetic operation. But even that is like really, it's like these are known as Turing targets. I just wanted you to see this because people will talk about Turing machines.
I missed something. What's writing on the tape? The head?
Oh yeah, like the head reads and writes on the tape. I mean the human, since like Turing defined it to be a person, like a human is just like peering through a hole. Like the human, the machine never sees anything on the other side of the tape. So you're just seeing the hole and you have this instruction. Okay, but the thing is,
just to clarify, are you saying that the Turing machine can or cannot do that parallel storage or functioning?
It doesn't have state, I believe. Well, there's a computer science concept called state, and I think this would be defined as a stateless machine, or like this, the algorithms don't have state, so like it can't know what it's done. Like it is only a program that can react to like the input. Do you have anything to say about that? About statefulness and non-stateful?
I think you've answered the question. It can do it, but not using what we would consider the method that...
Yeah, there are no variables.
Or so to do it.
Yeah, sorry, that's correct. Yeah. Like, you actually don't have to have variables in your programming language. Like, that's just a nice... that's pretty nice if your programming language gives you variables. Okay, I'm not going to go into the second example because the Turing machine is a really big place to get bogged down, but... One of the cool things to realize about Turing machines is that Turing machines does an operation on data. The data is on the tape. The data is doesn't necessarily have to be numeric, but like in this case it is. One of the cool things to realize is that every program, and this is even true in all programming languages like JavaScript or whatever, are like sequences of instructions, and they're a sequence of a limited number of instructions. Like there are just so many for loops or while loops. In this case, there are only so many states you can go into because we declared that the states are only found in these states. This means that we can assign a number, like there's just like so many combinations of instructions, and that means that you could assign every instruction a number, and because there are only finitely many. A program has finitely many instructions. Every program can be associated with a number. So, like, there is the one program, there's four states here, so it's four, and then this can be, like, another, if our language has only two letters in the alphabet, then this can only be two things, so it's four times two, times this print can be only one of two things, or in this case none. So like, okay, four times three times three times two directions times four here. So like every program is only one of a limited number of possible sequences. Plus, added to the fact that this program is only finitely long, there are just only of finitely many programs that can ever exist. And because there are only finitely many programs, we can just assign a number to every program. Anybody lost it? That's really key. And I said it quickly.
Right, it gives you a different level of abstraction beyond.
Yeah. So just imagine that every program that you could write in any language could be given a number. Okay. And now, every data, so you also must accept for this argument to work that all programs are, that all computations are programs running on data. Even if there's no data, it's just like there is some programs, computations are programs running on data. There's a, every program can have a number. Since the data is infinite, or is finite, if you have a finite many, many programs and finitely many data, well, like, they can be infinitely many, but they can all be numbered. That's a concept known as being recursively enumerable, which is like being able to give a number to an infinite sequence. So, there are programs have numbers, data have numbers, Turing machines operate on numbers. Put that together, you have this concept of the universal Turing machine. So, the universal Turing machine, and this is where your mind should be blown only slightly, is that, like, this is a number, but this number also represents a program somewhere, and, like, also represents some data. So a universal Turing machine is a machine that takes in a program and takes in data and performs the program on the data. Okay, so what that means is now your machine can compute anything. And why that's really important is because previously in the 1930s it was like, okay, we're going to need to make a machine that does multiplication or a machine that does addition. But now it's like, we have a machine that accepts a program and a data and performs the program on the data and can do anything. So now we have our computers, is like an arbitrary, can compute arbitrary programs. And that's what the things that you're holding in your laps can do. They can compute anything that you can command them to compute. That's why they're a general purpose computer. So the Turing machine is important just because it showed the universality of computing, or to make a machine that could make it, could be a universal computer. So it's not a machine that does one thing, it's a machine that operates programs on data. Pause. Okay? Okay. Now I'm going to erase everything.
See, I missed the point where the ones and zeros are all that you can have, and then you map that to instructions.
Okay, so what's this 4 times 4 times, so that's 4 squared, which is 16 times 3 times 9. Can just someone tell me what 16 times 9 times 2 is? That's 32 times 9. Okay, let's just give an upper bound on it. What's that?
About 288.
Okay. So there's like, every instruction is one of 288 instructions. So let's say that this is instruction 168 or whatever, and this is like 169 or something, and this is 207, and this is 7. And so, like, I can just put these in a string, and I can just say that this program is I can't just write this digits out. I have to do it in this weird way, which is called Gödel numbering. And this is the point in math, which is has the funniest title, which is called the phone call from God. And the phone call from God says that every number will be unique if I take these and I like write out all the prime numbers like this. This. And then I put these numbers as the exponents. And then because of the prime factorization theorem, this is like a unique number. It's actually this. So if you multiply that out, which is like an astronomical number, that's the unique number that represents this program.
And you selected those digits arbitrarily, because they're between 0 and 300.
Oh, these are just the first 4 prime numbers.
No, of course. Oh. But the exponents.
Oh yeah, these could be anything. Like, we just decide, there are our namespace is 288 instructions. And so I just assign, I just have to make a mapping between instructions and a number between 288. So that's the phone call from God. You can read more about it. So that's how you get your unique number for your program. So you put a program in here, and then the data is like, well, that's just finite as well, because,
yeah,
like, if I'm multiplying 4, then it's just doing my arguments to my program.
And how does it know data versus instructions?
Well, like, you just make an instruction for Turing machine that accepts two arguments, an instruction argument and like a program argument and a data argument, and then does that. And it's probably going to have like millions of lines or something. It's a really complicated thing, but And I don't think anybody has ever written it. It just is proved to exist in this way.
Yeah. Okay. So, I'm going to tell you to forget everything and move much closer to what modern computers do. Okay. So, the universal... What is RAM? Someone just
random picked up. Access memory.
Okay. And how much of it do these computers have?
Not enough.
But more than ever.
More than ever.
Okay. And what is it? What is random access memory?
It's just storage space where you can put zeros and ones and pick track them back. You can write and read zeros and ones basically.
But it's different and better than a tape because you can do it at any spot. You don't have to keep rewinding.
You can just like jump to the spot you want, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and who knows what, does anybody want to give an explanation for what an instruction set is of a computer chip?
Those are the programs that you just drew.
Yeah, well, that was a series of instructions. Unlike today's modern programs, like every chip has a different instruction set. And I think like Intel chips are like known as x86 chips or something like that. And they have like a very big instruction set. The reason mobile phones have these things called like RISC chips, which are like reduced instruction sets. And so like every chip just knows how to perform certain operations on data. I'm going to show you a machine, which is a very simple machine, which has an instruction set of, I think, I'm going to include three things. So if you're using pen and paper now is a good time to draw the picture that I'm about to draw a bit better. Maybe I'll draw it a bit better. So we have our RAM, and in this case, I'm going to call these registers. And it's only infinite in one direction, but I'm not going to ever use all the memory. And this is register 1, or register 0, register 1, register 2, register 3, register 4. Each register is a cell of memory, essentially, that can store a positive... a non-negative integer in it. So, like, there's just going to be a non-negative integer in this cell at some point. This is the register. The instruction set is again, our program is going to be defined as a list of instructions, and our instruction set will be something like, we're going to have the clear command. So clear RI means set that thing to zero, or like put zero in that in the register RI. There's going to be the successor function, which means take the number that is in RI, add one to that value, and then put it back in the cell. Mm-hmm. And yeah, okay. And then there's going to be the jump compare method. So jump compare takes like RI and RJ, and it takes also PU and PV, and it's like it compares RI and RJ, and if RI and IJ are equal, then it will go to PU, but if they're not equal, it goes to PV. And our program is like a sequence of PU1 through PN. Okay, so that's the all programs are going to look like. It's a sequence of finite instructions that are of this form. So now we're going to do something with them. Oh, and by default, our input will come in on R0, and then when our program stops, the return value is going to be stored in R0 as well. So let's compute the function f of x equals x plus 5. And I think, yeah,
have to like define the return value to be somewhere else or something. Okay, so how do we do this?
You could go down in time and just make new
registers. New registers. I might do that. I might just erase frantically. Okay, so I think depending on the way you do it, there's like okay, so we're gonna get an extra. Our program is going to get in. We're gonna compute the plus 5 function, so we're gonna get x, and we're also going. I think that for convenience, I'm going to. We can either define it so that the 5 comes in as an input for us to compare, or we can define it that we can set any register to a constant. So which would you prefer? Does that make sense?
Constant.
Okay. We also have const, and, well, that's, okay, I'm actually going to do it the other way, because this way is less magical. Okay, so then we're going to get, like, all the operations, so we're going to get x in here, and we're going to get 5 in this register, and we have to return whatever x is plus 5. So now we have x in here and 5 in here, and we want to move, well, let's just say we'll return this. I'm going to return this one. So the way that you would do this is, okay, my output is going to be in register 3 at the very end. This could be easier if we had copied though. I'm just going to do this with a minimal number of operations. So 0 is, okay, the program is going to look like this. I'm going to clear register 2. And then I'm going to successor r 0, and then I'm going to successor r 2, so 0 in here, and then I'm going to jump between 1 and r 1 and r 2, and if it's successful. If these are the same, then no, I have to. No, this is right. Okay, sorry. I'm just going to explain to you before I write it down. Our strategy will be this: we're going to set this to 0. We're going to add 1 to both of these, so this will become. We're going to add 1 to both of these, so this will become 1. Then we're going to compare these two. If they're not equal, we're going to go to the portion of our program which compares these two things again. And if it's not equal, then we're going to add 1 again. And if they're equal, then we're going to return this. Okay, so the reason that will work is because this. Okay, so now we're going to have x plus 2, x plus 3. This will be 0 plus 1, 0 plus 2. Plus 3, plus 4, plus 5. This will be, at this point, this will be x plus 4, x plus 5. At this point, this is going to remain constant. These two will be the same, and now we have x plus 5 in our output register. So we've just added a constant number of 1s, and what we did was we just kept on checking to see if these things were equal, and then we were at the same time adding 1 to the input, and eventually these two things were equal, and then we returned the correct answer. Make sense? Okay. So this is in our language here. Jump. We're going to compare these two, and if it's not equal, we're going to go to P1. And if it is equal, then we're just going to go to P4. Let's call this P4. And P4 is return. Okay. So, I'm now going to issue the challenge of computing the function f of x equals 2 times x. Does anybody have an idea about how it can be done? Using these, a sequence of this instruction set.
What was the
thing you could do is instead of adding 5, you could add x to another x.
Right. Key insight. We don't even have addition. We only have plus 1. So we have to convert our operations downwards into the plus domain. And once we've done them in the plus domain, then we can do them in the plus 1 domain. Because, after all, repeated, so this is like really a key insight. Addition, there's like addition, and addition, multiplication is repeated addition, right? And actually, there's a level of operation below addition, which is called zeration, which is the plus 1 command. So it's like, this can be translated to this, and this is actually like x plus 1 done 5 times. So like, using this, I translated this operation into this operation. So now, if I can just translate this operation into this operation, then I'm perfectly, then it's, so this is zeration. This is addition. And this is multiplication. So in fact, f of 2x is equal to x plus x, which is an addition, which I just like shifted into this domain, and then once I'm in this domain, I know how to shift it down here. So does anybody want to try and like write what the formal program might look like? I think I could do it. Or we could try and do it together. So I think it would be like, the strategy is like, you get x in here, and then we're also going to have like, we're going to multiply 2 times. So we're going to have a counter. Okay, so we're going to set this to 0 and set this to 0, and then we're going to have like an inner loop, which is like, I'm going to keep on adding, okay, I'm going to have to copy, yeah, so these are 0, then like, say this is going to be I will like keep on adding 1 until it's the same value as x, and then I will also increment this to 1, and then I will check to see if I've done the right number of additions, which it isn't because this is just 1x, and then I'll do that over again, so I'll put another x in here, and then I'll increment this 1 to 2, and then 2 plus, then these two will be equal, so I'll return. So I've now added x to itself, the right number many times. So there's just like another loop inside that.
Can you execute it?
Okay, I will execute it. I will, and then, okay. What value would you like x to be?
3.
Okay. So 2 comes in. I'm going to set these to 0. Okay. There's like a concept of an outer loop and an inner loop here. So I'm going to, the x is 3. Okay. I'm going to check to see if these are equal. And they're not. So I'm going to proceed to my inner loop. And then I'm going to add 1 to this register and check to see if it's equal to the input, and it's not. So I'm going to keep on doing that until it's, oh wait, that's still not equal. And so, okay, they're equal. So now I'm going to like break out of the inner loop using the jump command, and I'm going to add 1 to here. And then I'm going to be in my outer loop, and my outer loop says, like, are these equal? And it says, no, they're not equal. Proceed to the portion of the program which is in the inner loop. And the inner loop says, okay, so I would have had to copy x over here. So let's just imagine that, I copied x over. Because I have to make sure this is equal to something. So, okay, so I use another piece of memory, and it's says, like, am I going to fill this up till it's 3 again? And then... I think that I may have to have copied this earlier, or just set this as the return thing. I'm just thinking, yeah, it's like... Okay, now in this, okay, so here's how it works. I'm going to add, I would clear this again, and then I would add one to both of these until this one was equal to this one. So I'm going to add one to both of these, which is like 4 and 1. Are these equal? No. Are these equal? No. Are these equal? Yes. Okay. Then I come back, I go back into my outer loop, and my outer loop increments this, and then my outer loop says to check if these two things are equal, and they are, and so then I'm at the halting part of my problem, and my output is in register 3.
Why did you have to do the last part?
I was just confused, but I think that it would always be like, I'm always going to be clearing, at the beginning I would clear both of these, and then when I entered in the inner loop, I would clear this one every time. Hmm. And then this one would remain accumulating, but this one would be cleared at the beginning of the inner loop. So it's... I feel bad for not having explained it very well, but it's like you can see how inhuman it's supposed to be, but it does work.
But it's a step up from the previous system that has memory.
Yeah, like oh my god, we're writing to memory. Okay, yeah. So that's a register machine. So maybe we can try writing this program. Would that be useful to anybody to write it in? This what is like almost similar to assembly language?
Sure.
Okay. So what did I do? What is P0? It was like clear, set that to 0, right? Clear R2. P1 was something like clear R3. P2 was something like clear R4. Then I did, then P3 was like jump, and it compared, it was this like the outer loop, right? And it compared R1 and R2. And if it was successful, then let's just like make P10 down here, and I'll like to put it over here. This is like return. P50 return, or like done. And so if successful, go to P50. If unsuccessful, go to the inner loop, right? So the inner loop will start here. So P4 inner loop was. Okay, actually, I wanted to clear only on the inner loop for this one, as I remember. So it was like clear R4, and then P5 was, and 6 were to increase both of these. So successor R3, P6, successor R4. Jump P7, jump between, compare these two, right? Jump R0, R4. If successful, where do I go? I'm writing too small for people to see.
The outer loop.
Okay, the beginning of this loop is P5.
Yeah.
Okay, so if successful, P5. If if successful, we want to go to this other portion, which increments it. So like this is P8, which is like successor, add one to this register.
Yep.
Then P9, jump to P3, which is the compare. It compares R0, R4. If successful, go to P3. Otherwise, it's this instruction. Because this is this. Sorry, I just got to this. Okay. So we were at this thing. So if these aren't done yet, then this goes to P8, which increments this thing a little bit. And if it's unsuccessful, we continue the inner loop, which starts at P5. And so then this one increases that one and checks to see if these two are equal, and if not, goes back to the inner loop. Okay, so this compares R1 and R2. And then goes back to the inner loop, which is P5. Okay, that is the program. That's what's known as assembly language. A certain type of assembly language, the universal machine. All your code on your computer, whatever language you write it into, is going to get translated by a machine like a C compiler or something that is going to transform it into this extremely laborious code that will be... Every processor has these things called this instruction set. And the instruction set is going to be like a series of like... just like plus one functions and like some really bad functions that like, are completely like low level. And then like your Python or JavaScript interpreter is going to interpret them into a language like this. So you may not, like, you're actually programming in, like, a very nice version of this when you're writing your pure programming languages. But it all goes, like, at the very lowest level, it all gets translated through a language like this to opt for the computer chip to calculate it. Any questions on that? Yes?
Just a quick follow-up to establish, when we're using X as a variable, kind of in the first example, when you were able to set one of the R categories, which is R2, as zero, in none of the instructions, is there a setting of any of the, like, for instance, R1 was never defined? So I'm curious as to what would be in R1 if we were to begin there.
So there's just a convention, which is like the arguments of the function it wants to compute come in, like how Substack this morning, like, was, do you remember it was like first equals $1, second equals $2? But like by convention, the arguments that are being supplied to us get put in these registers.
Perfect. Yeah.
It's just a kind of like, we have to start somewhere. Like our inputs have to magically appear in our registers in order for the theoretical thing to work. Okay. It can be done. This is your challenge. Over the line is to compute this function. So f of x is equal to x minus 1. Subtract 1 from a number using only the addition and the jump operator, the successor and the jump operation. And I'll give you the result, solution tomorrow. Okay. Everybody silent? What time is it? Okay, I'll quickly describe what the halting problem is. Have you ever used a Macintosh computer, and has it ever frozen on you.
Yes.
Okay. And like this spinning beach ball of death comes up. And like sometimes the spinning beach ball of death like stops and it like becomes better and you can use your computer again. But sometimes, like no matter what happens, the beach ball just spins forever. And like after 10 minutes or like half an hour, you just like have to press the power button so it will shut down. Have you seen this phenomenon? The haunting problem can be like explained as my Mac is freezing, as it probably does because it's programmed in a proprietary way. And can I get another computer, either a Macintosh or not a Macintosh, and plug it into my spinning beach ball of death computer? And can the second computer, which is plugged into this the frozen one, tell me if that frozen computer is going to eventually stop crashing, like will eventually recover from the beach ball state, or will it always be in the beach ball state? And so what do you think? Can there be a good computer that you can plug into a crashing Mac that tell you if the Mac will recover?
An efficient market?
Efficient market.
I think you could get a computer that could do it better than you could. But not 100% mathematically.
The thing is, yeah, exactly. Like it's like working through some process, but like that process is just might be like infinite. It might be stuck in an infinite loop. Like if you programmed a little bit, you may have like programmed it. Who's programmed an infinite loop before in any programming language? Okay, that's like half. We can do it really quickly in any programming language, but you just like, there's a while loop and you just say while true.
You did one already.
What's that?
You did one in assembly already.
Okay, here's the assembly infinite loop. P zero. Okay, clear R1. Clear R2. Jump. Is R1 equal to R2? If not, okay, then there's like return. Okay, so this is 1, 2, 3. 3 is done or return. Let's just call it return. Okay, so if they're this, if they're the same, go back to P0. And if they're not the same, return. Okay. 0, 0. Is 0 equal to 0? Yes, do this. Set this to 0, this, set this to 0. Is 0 equal to 0? So it's like that one. So like sometimes your Mac is like, it's just like doing this ridiculous computation that will never end, and that's why you have to shut it down, because it's stuck in an infinite loop. So can a computer detect if the thing, can another computer detect if the first computer is an infinite loop? And the answer is basically no, because it's like, well, you could probably analyze that by static program analysis, maybe. But the second Mac can't tell. Like, the second Mac could only, like, try and run the code of the first Mac, but even if it did it faster, it would never be able to, like, speed its way out of the infinite loop. And that's basically what the haunting problem says, is that, like, there are some infinite loops, and you can, there's a clever way to, like, run all the programs at the same time. That's... Just think, when people talk about the Hawking's problem, just think about the problem of one Mac being plugged into a second Mac and one of them freezing and the other, and it trying to figure out if it's frozen but not being able to because the frozen one is in an infinite loop that it can never recover from. Okay. And then if you're really, really interested, at 6 o'clock or a little bit after, I will explain how to compute all the computations that could ever be computed all at the same time and still have it such that the infinite ones would never return, but the ones that would return would eventually return. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, so what do you think? Is theoretical stuff good, or is it just like, why aren't we building websites?